to heaven. I'm walking up the King's highway. Yes, it's a highway to heaven. Oh, none can walk up there. Oh, but the pure in heart. It's a highway to heaven. I'm walking up the King's highway. Oh, yes, my way is brighter. My burden's lighter. Walking up the King's highway. And there is joy in knowing with Him I'm going. I'm walking up the King's highway. Oh, it's a highway to heaven, and none can walk up there. Oh, but the pure in heart. It's a highway to heaven. I'm walking up the King's highway. Yes, my way's brighter, my load gets lighter, walking up the King's highway. And there is joy in knowing with Him I'm going. I'm walking up the King's highway. Oh, and it's a highway to heaven, and none can walk up there. Oh, but the pure in heart. It's a highway to heaven. I'm walking up the King's highway. Yes, it's a highway to heaven. I'm walking, but the pure in heart. It's a highway to heaven. I'm walking up the King's highway. Anybody walk in that direction? Oh, hallelujah. Lift your hands and praise Him. Come ahead, Brother Marino. Glory, glory, glory. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. I'm going back with Jesus when it comes. Blessed be the name of the Lord. We're on the winning side. We're going to make it by the help and the grace of God. Turn, shake somebody's hand. Tell them I'm going that way.
Well, sweet is the song I'm singing today. Well, I'm redeemed. Well, trouble and sorrow have vanished away. I have been redeemed. Well, I'm redeemed by love divine. Oh, glory, glory, Christ is mine. I now resign. I have been redeemed. Well, I'm redeemed by love divine. Oh, glory, glory, Christ is mine. My all to Him. I now resign. I have been redeemed. Well, sweet is the song I'm singing today. Well, I'm redeemed. Well, trouble and sorrow have vanished away. I have been redeemed. Well, I'm redeemed by love divine. Oh, glory, glory, Christ is mine. I belong to Him. I now resign. I have been. Great is my joy. Now with onward I go. Well, I'm redeemed. And all the way homeward, my praise shall flow. Oh, I have been redeemed. Well, I'm redeemed by love divine. Oh, glory, glory, Christ is mine. Indeed, my Savior to me. Well, I'm redeemed, and happy in glory someday shall be. I have been redeemed. Well, I'm redeemed. I love divine. Oh, glory, glory, Christ is mine. All in, I now resign. I have been redeemed again. Well, I'm redeemed by love divine. Oh, glory, glory, Christ is mine. All in, I now resign. I have been redeemed. Well, precious indeed is my Savior to me. Well, I'm redeemed, and happy in glory someday shall be. Oh, glory, glory, my Christ is mine. All in, I now resign. I have been redeemed again. Well, I'm redeemed. You know, sometimes you just got to put it on the altar. You know, thing, you put something on the altar, you know what they do on the altar? They burn it. It consumes it. You don't get it back. You put it on the altar, it better be there because you're leaving it there. Because it's going to be consumed. Amen. Hallelujah. Let's sing Standing on the Promises. Standing on the promises of Christ my King, through eternal ages let His praise and ring. Glory in the highest I will shout and I'll sing. Standing on the promises of God, well, I'm standing on the promises of God, my Savior, standing on the promises of God. Well, I'm standing on the promises that cannot fail. When the howling storms of doubt and fear assail, I said by the living word of God I shall prevail. Oh, I'm standing on the promises of God. Well, I'm standing, oh, I'm standing, standing on the promises of God, my Savior, standing. I'm standing on the promises of God. I was reminded back when I had my plumbing company and things had turned bad on us. We hadn't gotten a job in over 6 months. Times were really hard. We hadn't had anybody even call us in a month. And I remember the Lord spoke to my heart. He said, I'm going to give you a job this coming week, and I want you to go tell somebody. And so He said, I want you to tell your wife. So I went and told my wife. He said, I want you to tell your mom. I went and told my mom. But He said, I want you to tell your partner. Well, my partner wasn't a Christian, and I didn't know how that was going to go because, I mean, we didn't have... There wasn't no signs of a job. And I remember I went in there and said, Cody, I'm just going to tell you what the Lord told me. The Lord told me He's going to give us a job this coming week. And the following week came, and we didn't get one job. We got 3 jobs. Because you can stand on the promises of God. Let's sing it. Well, verse number 2, standing on the promises that cannot fail. When the howling storms of doubt and fear assail, by the living word of God I shall prevail. Well, I'm standing on the promises of God. Well, I'm standing, oh, I'm standing. on the promises of God. Well, I'm standing on the promises.
How many did you tell?
Three people.
How many jobs did you get?
I got three. Isn't that amazing?
What if he had told 45? Somebody needs to grab a hold of it in this house. This evening. Hallelujah. Somebody needs to stand on the promise.
Amen. Let's sing verse 2 again. Well, standing on the promises that cannot fail. When the howling storms of doubt and fear assail, I said, by the living word of God, I shall prevail. Well, I'm standing on the promises of God. Well, I'm standing, oh, I'm standing, standing on the promises of God, my Savior. On the promises of God. Well, I'm standing on the promises of Christ the Lord, bound to Him eternally by love's stronghold. Well, I'm overcoming daily with the Spirit's sword, and I'm standing on the promises of God. Standing on the promises of God, my Savior. Standing, well, I'm standing. I'm standing on the promises of God. Well, I'm standing on the promises, I cannot fall. Listening every moment to the Spirit's call. Resting in my Savior as my all in all. Well, I'm standing on the promises of God. Well, I'm standing, standing. Well, I'm standing on the promises of God, my Savior. Standing, standing. I'm standing on the promises of God. Verse 2. Well, I'm standing on the promises that cannot fail. When the howling storms of doubt and fear us, oh, it's by the living word of God I shall prevail. Oh, I'm standing on the promises of God. Well, I'm standing, standing, standing on the promises of God, my Savior. On the promises of God.
Amen. We can stand on His promises. Sing victory in Jesus. Amen. I heard an old story, how a Savior came from glory, how He gave His life on Calvary to save a wretch like me. I heard about His groaning, of His precious blood's atoning. Then I repented of my sin and won the victory. Cause the blind to see. And then I cried, dear
broken. Come and heal my broken spirit. Oh, and somehow Jesus came and brought to me the victory. Oh, victory in Jesus. Oh, my Savior forever. Well, he saw me and he bought me with his redeeming blood. Well, he loved the air, I knew him, and all my love is due him. Well, he plunged me to victory. I heard about a mansion he has built for me in glory. And I heard about the streets of gold beyond the crystal sea. About the angels singing and the old redemption story. Oh, and some sweet day. Song of victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. Well, he saw me and he bought me with his redeeming blood. Well, he loved the air, I knew him, and all my love. Well, he plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing blood. I heard about his healing, of his cleansing power revealing, how he made the lame to walk again, and he called the blind to see. Spirit. Oh, and somehow Jesus came and brought to me the victory. Oh, victory.
Hallelujah. Lift your hands and praise him. Thank you, Lord, for the precious victory. Glory, 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 glory. God bless you as you're seated as a choir. Lift your hands and praise Him tonight. Bless His name. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, and all that is within me. Bless your holy name. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, and forget not all of His benefits. Forgiveth all thine iniquities and healeth all thy diseases. Who redeemeth thy life from destruction, crowneth thee with loving kindness, tender mercies, satisfieth thy mouth with good things, so thy youth is renewed like the eagles. Bless the Lord. Bless the Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, choir. Thank you for your help tonight. So appreciate each and every one of you being here with us in the house of the Lord tonight. We serve a faithful God. We serve a faithful God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I'm believing that this is going to be the last we've heard of COVID. Well, I tell you, I hope he's right. I think the sting, I'm praying, it's lost its gumption. And I tell you what. I'm sick and tired of fear. Somebody told us the other day, said, you can forget it. You can forget it. There's all kinds of research. A lot of the folks that left the church said they ain't coming back, according to studies. But I got news for you. God said, this is upon this rock I'll build my church. And the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. I just got news for you. I wouldn't want to miss a service. Because there is a breakthrough that's coming, I believe, like we have never seen before. I believe the greatest days are ahead. I got three people that agree with me on that. In the last day, saith God, I'm going to pour out my spirit upon all flesh. Pour it out, Lord, pour it out. It is a joy tonight to have Sister Alicia Webb. I want her to come. She's going to take just a moment and share with you what she is doing, and then we're going to receive an offering for her. And I want her to share that before we receive the offering. And so you will be blessed. Now, the other day, a man came to my house. That's actually been two or three days ago because my air conditioner quit. And an AC with hot weather and a snowman can be dangerous. I've known him for a long time. He gave me a wheel of a deal. But there was a service charge before he ever showed up. The labor is worthy of the hire. And we are going to be a blessing tonight to Sister Alicia. I've heard so many excuses as to why people don't go. But she has done away with the excuses. And she is going. And we appreciate you, Sister Alicia. Before you come, I want you to know that Faith Tabernacle appreciates you. There is young ladies in this congregation that you was with in school, and nobody knows you better than those that you go to college with. They see you when you get spiked on the volleyball court. They see you how you act when the weather's cold, when you have a term paper due, or things don't go your way. And I have heard nothing but high praise for a sister that not only speaks well and does well, but lives well. And I want you to welcome our missionary as she comes to the platform tonight, Sister Alicia Webb. Would you come, sister? God bless you.
Well, good night, everybody. It's very good to be here. I was sitting there and I was thinking there are more friendly faces as far as like I know those people here than anywhere except maybe Bible Holiness. And so I always love coming to Faith Tabernacle. And then I get all these people I don't know and they come and tell me how much they know my mom and dad. So I want to tell all y'all, they said hi, and my brother Brian, I'm staying with him over this weekend. He also says hi, and they appreciate y'all for letting me come and share. So if you don't know me, my name is Alicia Webb. I grew up as a missionary kid in the Southwest Pacific, in Tonga and in Vanuatu. Vanuatu is between Australia and Fiji. It's a long chain of islands, about 83 inhabited islands. There are about 315,000 people that live there. A third of those are under the age of 15. And as a child growing up there, I enjoyed taking part in my parents' ministry, but I did not want to go back. And it was God leading me step by step, first at OBI and then through different volunteering opportunities back to Vanuatu for that one third, for those children. So I work primarily on providing the churches there with biblical, culturally appropriate Sunday school curriculum in their language, and then training local teachers and setting up and running their Sunday school with the curriculum. So I want to thank you all for your support over the past 2 years, your prayers, and the money that keeps me there and keeps the ministry going. I could not have done it without you, and I really, really appreciate it. Thank you. Now, I don't know if we got the screen going or not. That was at one of our trainings, giving one of the Sunday school books to Pastor Steve John, and I want to tell you a little bit about the 2 years. I won't go in depth because that would take ages. So, first, next slide, was the challenges. We've all had our challenges, and ours included COVID. Even though we didn't have COVID there on the islands, it caused a massive shutdown, so nobody in or out of the borders for quite a long time. Still, my parents have not been able to return. And then a month after the borders closed in March of 2020, then we were hit with a Category 5 tropical cyclone, Harold. And it was very devastating to the island that I lived on, Espiritu Santo, to Pentecost, and to Malo. And it's been about a year of rebuilding, but I want to thank you again for your prayers, for God keeping us safe, and for what he has provided to help the churches rebuild there. But it wasn't just challenges. We also had many victories. And my favorite is this first one. Well, I don't know. I call them all my favorite. But these six ladies, they are the reason that I was able to accomplish as much as I did. We worked together to translate and to format the Bible app for kids stories and parent engagement pages into a Sunday school curriculum for the churches of Vanuatu. So they are absolutely amazing. And then they helped me do the training. So we were able to do six Sunday school teacher trainings, each with about 50 participants. That's the next slide. And we taught them how to use the book, how to do the activities, the crafts. We had a lot of fun. We were able to do it in two provinces, in Sanma and in Torba. And it was really amazing to me. You know, I came at it with an expectation of they're going to learn how to use this and that's going to be great. But God really just moved in those times. We had services, we had devotions, we saw men and women saved, we saw them delivered, we saw some healed, we saw some filled with the Holy Ghost, and we hear amazing testimonies of what they're doing in their churches now. Next slide. I was also, unexpectedly on my part, privileged to teach at Sanma Bible Training Center. So I went there and I was like, Dad, I'm so glad I'm not like those other missionaries that are going to be teaching at the Bible school. And he said, well, he said, you just might be doing that. So keep your mind open. And that has been one of the great joys that I've had over the past 2 years. We actually had our largest class ever. Last year, we had 28 students enrolled, and I believe it was 13 graduated, and they are all out working in their communities. So it's a one-year Bible school that trains new believers to go and to disciple in their community, so like a brand new church plant, and that was a lot of fun. Okay, next slide. This, again, my favorite. These are weekend outreaches. So every weekend I would go with one or two of those ladies or pastor's daughter, and we would go do outreaches with children in villages around some of the new church plants, alongside some of the new church plants, and go and visit the established churches. And we were teaching that lesson of the prodigal son. And I remember sitting down with about a 12-year-old girl, Joanna, and she said, you know, I have heard stories from the Bible. Her teacher was there with us. She said, but now I know that God loves me, and I want to be a part of his family. And so God is changing lives every time that we share his word. We share it unashamed, unafraid. If we could go to the next slide, I want to share a story of this woman. Her name is Maris. She is one of our Sunday school teachers. She's one of my heroes. She is a single mother, and she and her extended family make up the entire village of Le Toro. Now, it is a beautiful village. It's set right across from a coconut plantation. You cross the river on this little stone dam that they've built, and then you climb, and you're huffing and puffing, and you get to the top, and it's just beautiful, neat grass. They've got all of the pathways lined with, like, purple and pink and green leaves. I didn't even know leaves grew that color. And all of the houses are thatch and bamboo, and it's absolutely beautiful. But I didn't know Maris. She came in January of 2021 to one of our trainings, and she took part. She's pensive, but, you know, she engaged, and she did really well. And I said hi. I prayed with her. We gave her her material, sent her off. It was actually Pastor Steve that sent her to us, and I met him a couple months later in town, and he said, missionary, Maris is teaching Sunday school in her village. I said, that is fantastic. I am so glad to hear that. That's what we're here for. And he said, I don't think you understand. You know, they're all new believers, and they don't have a pastor, and they don't have a church, and they don't have deacons or elders. So Maris is discipling their entire village. So in Sunday morning, she calls them together, and she goes through the lesson, teaches the songs, teaches the lesson, teaches the word of God, and they pray together. And she led 8 children to the Lord and 2 of the adults in her village. And sorry, I skipped over a few of those slides, but if we could go ahead and go to the video. This is a video that Pastor Steve showed me. And this is them singing one of their songs from the Sunday school book as they prepare to be baptized in water.
Me está aquí.
The song says, Father, you showed me the road to life, the life that you've given to me. Father, you've changed my name so that those who knew me before know I've changed. Today, I'm in the family of God. I have a new name in Christ. So when I came here last, I told you that there were so many of these children that I wanted to reach, and I knew I couldn't do it on my own. And so I wanted to be a part of equipping teachers like Maurice to do just this, to lead those children to the Lord and to disciple them in his word. God has gone above and beyond my dreams over these past 2 years, but I still have dreams, both for Vanuatu and beyond and throughout the Pacific Islands. So I ask you to continue to join me in this. I ask you to continue to support me in prayer, continue to support financially. And if you feel it on your heart that you want to go, either just for a short term or for a year, come talk to me after service. I'll tell you how you can do that.
Hallelujah. When I was there with the Rojacks at, I think we went to Fresh Wind, Fresh Fire. Fresh Wind? One of those pictures reminded me of the church. It was while I was preaching, a chicken jumped up on the wall. And Brother Rojack was interpreting, trying to shoo the chicken off, and it was just dancing. It wasn't going nowhere. We was all caught up on the chicken. And from the littlest to the oldest was very intently listening to every word that I had to say. I want to stand before the Lord and hear him say, well done, don't you? We can't all go, but we can help those that do go. Ushers, come. We want to worship the Lord in our giving tonight. We want to be a blessing. There's an envelope there. There should be a tab on the giving. If you want to go online and give for Sister Alicia, you can do that. Praise the Lord. I believe as laborers together, when we stand before the Lord, we can invest and be a part in what God is doing. Amen. Amen. Father, we thank you for our sister. We thank you for her desire to go and to travel and to take the gospel, the good news, to the children of Vanuatu in the Pacific. I pray that you would keep your hand upon her, minister, bless, meet every need. Bless in this service. Bless the gift and the giver. In the name of Jesus we pray. And everybody said, amen. God bless you as you give as unto the Lord.
I know most folks have a song or something for right now, but I can't play a single instrument. And the instrument God has given me of my voice, I keep mostly to myself. Trust me, you appreciate it. All right. Well, let's all turn to 1 Samuel chapter 14. The story runs from verses 1 through 23, but I'm just going to read verses 6 through 12. You know, there are some people that you just feel comfortable around them, don't you? We're going to read about one of them. 1 Samuel chapter 14, verses 6 through 12. And Jonathan said to the young man that bare his armor, "Come and let us go over unto the garrison of these uncircumcised. It may be that the Lord will work for us. For there is no restraint to the Lord to save by many or by few." Yes. And his armor bearer said unto him, "Do all that is in thine heart. Turn thee. Behold, I am with thee according to thy heart." Then said Jonathan, "Behold, we will pass over unto these men, and we will discover ourselves unto them. If they say thus unto us, 'Tarry until we come to you,' then we will stand still in our place and will not go up unto them. But if they say thus, 'Come up unto us,' then we will go up, for the Lord hath delivered them into our hand, and this shall be a sign unto us." And both of them discovered themselves unto the garrison of the Philistines. And the Philistines said, "Behold, the Hebrews come forth out of the holes where they have hid themselves." And the men of the garrison answered Jonathan and his armor bearer and said, "Come up to us, and we will show you a thing." And Jonathan said unto his armor bearer, "Come up after me, for the Lord hath delivered them into the hand of Israel." Yes. Let's pray. Father, I thank you so much for your incredible goodness to us. I thank you for your word that is true at all times. I thank you that you are encouraging us to trust you more each day. And I thank you so much for this opportunity. I pray that you would help me to honor you with how I present your word in Jesus' name. Amen. I'd also like to thank Reverend Snow for having me. Whenever I asked him if I should be ready to preach, he said, "Well, yes, sister, you should be ready to preach." And I was like, "Oh, my goodness. He's such a good preacher, and there's other really good preachers there, and I don't know if I'm going to be able to do this." But, you know, it's not about the messenger. It's about the message. So I want to talk to you about fearless faith. Like I said, some people, you like them. They're really great. They are fun to be around. When they come into the room, it makes everybody feel better. They tend to bring out the best in you. And that's how I imagine Jonathan. He seemed like a really great guy. He was a great son. He was a great leader. He was a great friend. He was generous. He was welcoming. He was very cool like a cucumber, like not stressed. I mean, if it was me and my dad threw a spear at me at dinner because my best friend didn't come to dinner, I think I would have reacted differently. But Jonathan, he gets up and he goes and he says, "Yep, David, you're in trouble. You should get out of here." I think all of these good qualities that we see in him stem from his faith in God. So when we come to this passage, we're at a point in Jonathan's life, a little over 2 years after his father has become king, and they are encamped with about 600 men on the far end of Gibeah in the south, in Migron, and the rest of the Israelites, they have either gone to the north and joined up with the Philistine forces, or they are hiding in the caves of the area. And then what does Jonathan do in this circumstance? He says to his armor bearer, "Let's go over there. If they call us up..." Now, I don't know if you've looked at a picture of these two sharp rocks. It says the name of the one was Bozez and the name of the other was Sinna, which basically means thorny and gleaming or miry, but, you know, translation, hard to climb. And they are very tall. And so what he's saying is, let's descend a very sharp rocky grade, and then climb another very sharp rocky grade, just hands and feet, no ropes, nothing, and then we're going to get the victory. And his armor bearer says, "I will go with you. Do all that's in your heart." And if it was me, I would be a little bit more like Thomas, like, "Okay, here we go, but we're going to die with him." You know, that's what he said. He said, "Let us also go that we may die with him." In other words, I don't think this is going to end well. It can't. There is no way this can end well. But God has shown himself time and time again that he does the impossible. So we can fearlessly attempt the impossible through faith when we are up against impossible odds. If you go back to chapter 13, it describes the army that they are up against. In verses 5 and 6, it says, the Philistines gathered themselves together to fight with Israel, 30,000 chariots and 6,000 horsemen, and people as the sand which is on the seashore in multitude. And Saul tarried in the uttermost part of Gibeah under a pomegranate tree, and the people that were with him were about 600 men. Those don't seem like good odds. Just don't think it's going to go well. And I think sometimes we look at the lostness of the world and we feel like those odds are just so bad, we don't even know where to start. We look at the strongholds that Satan has put in society around the world. We look at it and we're like, this is an insurmountable obstacle. We look at the numbers and realize that only 1 in 7 billion people know the Lord. How can we help a world that is so very lost? We can take a lesson from Jonathan. I don't know how many men were up at that garrison, but it does tell us that they fought off 10-1 before the rest of them started running away. That's worse odds than when we look at 1-7. We can do it. We can do it because we are going with God. And the awesome thing is that when they stepped out onto that uneven playing field and they engaged the enemy, the other Israelites that had gone and had joined the Philistine forces, they came back to Israel. And the Israelites that were hiding in the caves and they didn't want to be a part of it at all, they heard the commotion and they came out and they joined the fight. You know, as far as just a picture of odds, one of my favorite stories is about a high school team back in 2005. They were an underwater robotics team. It wasn't football or basketball. There were four of them, and it was a very underfunded school in Phoenix, Arizona, and they had entered this contest where their robot was going to have to go into a submarine mock-up and complete 7 objectives within a certain amount of time. And there were 2 different categories. They could go with the explorers, which was the college student level, and then they could go with the rangers, which was the high school student level. Well, they come at it with the mindset, we're not going to win anyway, so why don't we just go ahead and join the college student level, and then when we lose, it won't be quite as bad, you know? So they joined this college level. Well, also in the college level was a team from MIT. There were 12 students, 6 ocean engineering students, 4 mechanical engineers, and 2 computer science majors. They had a budget of $11,000 to build their robot. Carl Hayden had a budget of $800. They came into the competition with no expectations, really. They wanted to try, and they were giving it their best. And they actually placed 3rd in this competition as far as their robot's performance. Now, the overall winner, that was going to be determined by how well they answered questions on a review board and how well they had written their technical manual for the robot. And so they placed 3rd in the race course thing, and then they go into that interview and they feel like they've done really good. Then they go to the awards banquet, and the first prize offered is a special achievement award, and it goes to Carl Hayden High School. And they all get up there and they are so embarrassed, and they're like, oh my goodness, we did so bad, they had to give us the special award. And then they go and they sit down, and the next prize is called, and the next prize is called, and the overall winner prize is called, and it is Carl Hayden High School. They did not think they had a chance in the world. They just went in with one objective. They were going to do the best they could, and they won against impossible odds. You know, Jonathan, he wasn't focusing on his own efforts. He grew up. He was a descendant of Abraham. He grew up hearing the stories of how God had brought Israel into that promised land. He had heard of the amazing things God had done. And so it was not far-fetched to say that if God is with us, then he's going to give us the victory. So we can look at the odds and we can get discouraged and we can just say, you know what, forget it. We're not even going to try. Or we can look at our God and his track record in history, in the Bible, in our own lives, and we can say with Jesus, with man it is impossible, but with God everything is possible. We can fearlessly attempt the impossible through faith when we are few in number. It may be that the Lord will work for us, for there is no restraint to the Lord to save by many or by few. Now, when we look at the growth of the worldwide population since 2000, it's grown by a little more than 1.5 billion. But when we look at the growth of long-term cross-cultural missionaries, that has increased by only 30,000. So this means that there's about one missionary per 13,333 people. But you know, as I was praying about this service, something that God kept bringing back to my mind was, that's not really true, because a lot of those are kind of grouped together in these more popular places. And there are places where there are millions of people and only one missionary, or millions of people and no missionaries. And I was just breaking my heart, realizing how desperately we need more laborers in the harvest field. The laborers are few. Jesus already said it, but he also said that where two or three were gathered, he was in the midst of them. And the disciples, they believed that. With 12, they had reached another 120, and they were in that upper room. And then that 120 exploded into thousands. And in chapter 4 of Acts, we hear about them praying that God would increase their faith, their miracles, so that people could be saved. And we see God do that. In our own history in Vanuatu, back when it was called New Hebrides, we see how big the difference just one Christian witness can make. Dr. John Getty, a Presbyterian missionary, went to Anijam, it is the southernmost island in Vanuatu, back in 1848, and he worked there for God for 24 years. On a tablet erected to his memory in the church where he preached, these words are inscribed. When he landed in 1848, there were no Christians. When he left in 1872, there were no heathen. Hallelujah. We do need to be honest that we are very short on laborers, and we need to pray that the Lord of the harvest will send more laborers into the field. But we don't need to allow that to discourage us, because God can do incredible things with small numbers. It starts with one who is willing to step out, fearlessly trusting that God will bring the victory with just a few. We can fearlessly attempt the impossible through faith when we align ourselves with God's objectives. In verse 6, he says that it may be that the Lord will work for us. And then in verse 12, we see the Lord has delivered them into the hand of Israel. Now, Jonathan understood what God's objectives were. In the Old Testament, we see that God's desire was to show himself powerful to the heathens that were around the Israelites. In Joshua chapter 2, verses 9 through 11, we hear Rahab's testimony. And she says, I know that the Lord has given the land to you because I've heard. We've heard about what he has done. He's dried up the Jordan River and you just walked across. He gave you victory over the kings of Sihon and Og. She knew that God had power. God had shown himself powerful through the Israelites to their heathen neighbors. And God also desired to show himself powerful to the Israelite nation through their own weakness. So if we jump from Rahab's story into Judges and we get to chapter 6, we see Gideon. And Gideon's story is one of my favorites. I absolutely love his story. He was not a natural leader. He was scared. He went and he hid under the cover of dark to do what God had told him to do. He tested God. But when he stepped out in faith and he finally gets these guys together, God says, "You have too many." And they go down from thousands to 300. And Gideon, I'm sure, is thinking, "What on earth are you doing, Lord?" And God says, "I don't want you to go home and say that you won that victory. I want you to go home and say, God gave us the victory." God's desire is to show himself powerful to those who don't know him so that they will be saved. Again, like I said, in Acts chapter 4, the disciples' prayer was that God would increase their faith, that he would give signs and wonders so that people could be saved. And in Acts chapter 5, verses 12 through 16, we see God's answer to that. It says that the miracles done by the apostles were just overwhelming. People stood in awe. And it said believers were the more added to the Lord, multitudes of both men and women. There's a pastor in Espiritu Santo. He's a little bit like a diamond in a rough. His name is Pastor Fano, and he's tough and he's full of faith. He works in an area that is not pleasant. I visited them, and it was time to get our bath in the morning, so we're walking down to the river, and we're walking across the coconut plantation, and his brother-in-law starts yelling at us, and I'm like, "Oh my goodness, what'd we do wrong?" And he says, "Not that one. The cows pooped in that one. Come back to this one." So, you know, it's kind of a rough area, but He's so full of faith, and his reputation precedes him. He went to a wedding for a family member from the south part of the island. He lives in the north part, and it was near the village of Perus. And there in that village, there's a chief who had been bedridden for over a decade. I can't remember if it's 13 or 18 years, but a long time. And he heard about Pastor Fano, and he asked him, he said, "Would you come and pray for me?" And he came and he prayed for him. And that very same day, he was completely healed. And he stood up and he said, "I know your God is real. And I want my family to serve him." And he marked out. He said, "That's where the church is going to be. That's where you're going to put the Christian school. You just come and you do whatever you want to do here. We know your God has power." Hallelujah. God is not willing that any should perish, but he is willing to show his power so they can believe and be saved. And God is willing to show his power in your life, to increase your faith in him and your passion to share him with others. So trust him. Trust him with what seems impossible right now, whether it's your finances, whether it's a sickness, whether it's a relationship or a commitment that you feel like is overwhelming, whether it is lost family and friends or coworkers. Take it to him in prayer and obey when he asks you to take action. I think that sometimes we can forget. We can get focused on our own problems, and we can forget the need that is out there. We can forget those that are lost here and overseas. But I think more often, we have small expectations of God. We allow the challenges we face, the hurts that we've endured, to reshape what we think God can or will do. So I want to challenge each of us to be a little more like Jonathan. To ask God to grow your faith. I'm challenging you to believe God for the impossible. Believe him to give you the finances that you don't see so that you can send more missionaries. Don't just send me. Find some more. Send them overseas to contest what Satan has laid claim to because it's not his. And we need more out on the field. Believe him to give you more time. We never have a spare minute, do we? Never. but believe him to give you more time to pray, more time to engage with your church and be a part of what God is doing here in Denton. Believe him to work miracles when you pray for the sick. Believe him to save the lost when you share the gospel of Jesus Christ. Believe him to send laborers into the harvest field that is already ripe for harvesting. Come with a faith that is firm. Be like Jonathan and his armor bearer. Go and believe God to give the victory. I'd like to ask us all to stand. You know, there was another major person in this story, and his name was King Saul. And his faith was already shaken. He had already messed up. He had rushed ahead. He had done the sacrifices before Samuel showed up. And now he was there with the priest, and he's fasting and maybe, you know, laying out his battle campaign plan. We don't know. I'm sure he had the best of intentions, but he wasn't moving forward. It was Jonathan that stepped out in faith, trusting God rather than his own efforts. It was Jonathan that sent the Philistines running and emboldened the rest of the Israelites to stand up and fight. Yet, it was not Jonathan, but it was God that was in control of the situation. I'd like us to bow our heads. Father, I thank you. I thank you for your word. I thank you for this family that you have gathered here in this place. I know, beyond the shadow of a doubt, that you are calling someone tonight. And I pray that your Holy Spirit would work so strongly in them, that they would get up from that altar tonight knowing that they are going to serve you as your messenger for the rest of their lives. God, I pray that you would work in each of us to believe you for the impossible, to trust you, to do what we didn't think could ever happen in our lives, in the lives around us, and in the lives of those on the other side of the world. I thank you for it, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. If that's you tonight, if you're like, you know what? I haven't been walking in that faith like Jonathan. I want to invite you to come. I want to invite you to come and ask God to increase your faith and ask him to show you what that step is. Maybe it's to give more than you think you can. Maybe it's to set aside an hour to pray, to study your Bible. Maybe it's to talk to that person that always seems to just blow you off. They're not interested. If you hear God speaking to you tonight, I invite you to come. These altars are open.
Revival fire.